Chair and Deirdre, distinguished members of the Subcommittee, I'm glad to be here today. My name is Braithwaite, and I'm testifying today on behalf of the eHealth Initiative and its foundation, otherwise known as Neaman. I serve as the Chief Medical Officer of both organizations, which are independent, national, and nonprofit organizations, with missions overseen to improve the quality, safety, and efficiency of health and healthcare through information and information technology. In addition to our main work with Canadians, we work actively with Congress and administration to support these goals and apply their strong commitment. We highly look forward to working with you on potential legislation in this area. Let's talk a little bit about the big picture. The field of healthcare today is so vast and so complex that practicing medicine with an acceptable environment is proven to be humanly impossible without the support of integrated information technology. The number of deaths caused by medical errors in our healthcare system in the United States has been estimated to be around 100,000 or higher, if you include all the different aspects of healthcare. I think we all agree that this is not acceptable. In most cases, the healthcare system is at fault. We still practice medicine under the old paradigm where the doctor and the patient interact from memory to arrive at recommendations of healthcare decisions for the patient. The only way to significantly improve the quality, safety, and efficiency of our healthcare system is to bring the information system into the exam room, as it were, and to change the paradigm of clinical practice so that it routinely involves the doctor, the patient, and the computer working together to provide the best healthcare advice possible. The way to implement this new approach is through direct interaction with clinicians and patients with the clinical decision support system. Such a system must be integrated into the clinical environment in a way that supports rather than disrupts an efficient flow of the process of healthcare. But since most of the data in which clinical decisions are made actually originate outside the exam room, the clinical decision support system by itself cannot function without a way to access the sources of the clinical data, the laboratories, pharmacies, radiology centers, and so on. This then is the impetus for why has an emphasis on interoperable health information exchange initiatives. There are three critical prerequisites for successful implementation of health information exchange initiatives: incentives for implementation, assurances about privacy and security, and full interoperability between disparate clinical information systems. Even though all three are crucial, I will restrict this testimony to interoperability and you'll hear about that as from others in the panel. There's still some confusion in the healthcare industry about the meaning of the term interoperability. The definitions in my written testimony on page 5 come from an analysis of over 106 definitions done by the International Standards Development Organization, which is SAD. Basically, interoperability is the secure electronic communication of clinical data, like lab results, from a computer in one institution in such a way that a computer in another institution can understand the precise meaning of what was said. In this case, computer understanding means that the information could be processed by a receiving computer to reach conclusions about what advice to give to optimize patient care. The terminology used to describe clinical concepts must be standardized, controlled, and coded in enough detail to differentiate between closely related conditions that might require different treatments. For example, no matter what synonyms were originally used to identify the condition at the local hospital. In the last count, for example, there were 17 different terms used in different parts of this country that all refer to the same concept of high blood pressure. Larger categories of clinical concepts typically used for reimbursement transactions are not sufficiently detailed for this purpose. Interoperability also implies that there's a standard mechanism that all participants can use to exchange the information securely. Most of us use the World Wide Web every day. And understand the power of having such a communications infrastructure available to all. Healthcare, of course, requires ironclad security as part of its infrastructure, including features not required in standard internet, such as authentication, authorization, auditing, encryption, and digital signatures. Successful implementation of electronic health information across institutions requires specificity of standards and conformance testing of the results. Features not currently found in most of the standards available today, even if sometimes heard the proclamation that health information exchange should really control the standards of data. Is there anybody else who are fully aware of the data support? Enormous progress has been made in understanding specification and adoption of standards so far, but still need to have static. We must evolve to meet the continuous advances in delivering healthcare and can never be done. On the other hand, there are some more manual threat that we can address. Given that the timeline for so much rapidity between clinical information systems, in my opinion, is likely to be measured in decades. What can we do in the meantime to reap some of the value of the health information exchanges that we can implement today? If we focus our resources on a few projects that can successfully reach interoperability in the short term, we can demonstrate some of the immediate benefits. For people who are working toward the same goal using consistent standards, if you ask clinicians what information is most important when we see a patient without a medical record, as they had to do after Katrina, they quickly list medication history, allergies, lab results, problem lists, and interim reports. The patient, however, first wants to do away with the need to fill out the same data multiple times on the medical clipboard that each provider that they go to. So let's start with those needs in mind and solve some of the immediate problems. The industry has already made much progress on these particular needs, because the demand is there, and efforts in our contracts issued by HHS through the Office of the National Coordinator are focusing on the same situations in the context of prototypes for nationwide health information infrastructure. Results from these funded efforts are expected by the end of this year. In addition, important public sector partnerships such as the Rockwell Foundation's Connected for Health Initiative, with additional support from the Johnson Foundation, have provided a great deal of guidance on the technical aspects and the key principles and policies for information sharing. The standard for exchanging medication history and laboratory results is already being tested. Along with integration with lab ordering, lab test ordering is still being worked on. One approach for interpreting reports, which is one of the ways that people are looking for, is an electronic standard message that contains both a human readable representation of the data and a structured and coded form suitable for processing by the computer. Thus, most source systems that are only capable of producing a human readable form similar to a web page can still participate in the electronic health information exchange, while those systems with more capability can include the data that is formalized by a computer program and form of interoperability. This will allow migration over time from a simple and easy to produce form of data that is still compatible with the more sophisticated forms in both directions of communication.
Can I ask you to summarize for us, please?
Vendors are reluctant to spend money on implementing standards without customer willingness to pay for it. Providers are reluctant to pay for such features if they can't see immediate benefit. Therefore, purchasers have to be sure that the present and future value of standard-based systems and convinced to buy them when they're feasible. In conclusion, I believe we can provide appropriate incentives to implementation, adequate assurances to providers and patients about the privacy and security of their information, and support the full interoperability of our healthcare information systems. And we are, in doing so, we will insert the stage for a high-quality, safe, and efficient healthcare system for all Americans and their communities. And I will be there to help you if you can do this through legislation. I'd like to thank the committee for providing me the opportunity to share these insights on behalf of the community in this election.
Thank you. Mr. Mertz. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm Alan Mertz, President of the American Clinical Laboratory Association. The ACLA represents the nation's leading national, regional, and local laboratories. Mr. Chairman, most patients are probably familiar with our numbers, mostly by the boxes that see out in front of the doctor's office and across diagnostics or Medicare. That's where the specimens are put in those boxes. And our numbers are the people who collect those specimens, transport them to the laboratory, do the testing overnight, and report those results usually back the next morning, millions of times every day. And this testing is absolutely a critical part of our healthcare system. It provides the physicians with the objective data they need to not only diagnose, but effectively treat and monitor disease. Our members also, part of the reason we're here today, is that we have an extensive history of providing public health information technology, involving streamlining laboratory test requisition, and also speeding the delivery of test results. Let me give you just a little bit of background about laboratory testing and how important it is for the medical record, and we'll talk about that in some of the legislative proposals. Laboratories and the information they provide are really the heart of the medical record. It's not well known that, to the layman, that laboratory data actually represents 60% of the medical record. And while the diagnostic tests we do comprise only 1.6% of Medicare spending, and about 5% of overall health spending, they influence 70% of clinical decision making. And not only does this information improve outcomes and decrease costs, but laboratory data is becoming even more essential building block for assessing quality care, and it's playing an increasingly critical role in clinical quality and clinical performance initiatives. The laboratories, Mr. Chairman, made a tremendous investment in connecting to physician offices and hospitals, and sort of served as the catalyst in the evolution of health IT. Just wanted to give you one example of the penetration that they've had with the physician's offices. Quest Diagnostics, our largest member, has business relationships with half of the physicians and hospitals in the United States, and this is just one laboratory company. Quest Diagnostics receives 40% of its orders and sends 60% of its results via the internet. This critically important, this is a critically important and highly valued function. It's so important that since 1995, our labs have had a limited exception under the STAR plan so that they can provide these electronic connections and interfaces with physician offices. And this kind of fundamental capability for laboratories to render services to providers is a function that must be maintained and any changes are made at the STAR. Congressman Brown made a point at the beginning about the IOA report on errors and duplication costs. Electronic ordering and results with laboratories is a critically important part of improving legibility, decreasing error rates, producing more timely results, and even monitoring duplicative testing. I want to talk just about three quick points about HR 4157. We believe it has several needed improvements. Number one, we believe that if it was enacted, it would further prompt adoption of health IT. We believe that any exemption in the law for STARP for IT should be carefully crafted to guard against abuses while still allowing the diffusion of IT. We believe it strikes that balance. We also support the legislation's federal preemption of state laws that contradict the STARP law exceptions and anti-kickback safe harbors. Today, there are several state laws that are complicated and have different requirements than the federal STARP law. We believe that the preemption provisions there are very important. HR 4157 also addresses the need for federal preemption and state laws related to privacy. We support this provision because of the patchwork of state laws is an impediment to health information exchange. Let me give you one example. LabCorp and other large national laboratories have been invited to participate in regional Medicare chronic care and health support pilot programs. Chairman Deal, LabCorp has been invited to participate in the effort in your own state with Sydney Healthcare in Georgia, as well as a program operating in Central Florida, operated by Greater Than Health. These entities will offer self-care guidance and support to chronically ill Medicare beneficiaries to help them manage their diabetes, chronic disease problems. LabCorp's role in the programs will be to transmit critical laboratory data to Sydney to Greater Than Health for those beneficiaries who voluntarily participate in the program. However, the state laws in Florida and Georgia governing the release of lab results have prevented LabCorp from transmitting these results. In essence, Florida and Georgia laws preclude provider test results to anyone other than an ordering physician, and there's no provision in those state laws that would allow even the patient to give their consent. These laws would effectively bar any transmittal, and even the patient's consent does not allow us to transmit those results. Let me conclude also with the provisions regarding moving from ICD-9 diagnostics to ICD-10. Under the Medicare program, the laboratories are paid by including these ICD-9 codes on their claims to provide medical necessity. These codes are provided by the physician to the laboratory and are subsequently attached to the claim and submitted to CMS. So we really have no control of what diagnosis codes are put into the claim. If they're not done correctly, we're not paid. So moving to the ICD-10, we want to be Tested denied provides about 13,000 diagnosis codes. Moving to diagnosis, ICD number 10 provides 120,000 diagnosis codes, making it much more complicated. I've attached some examples of my testimony where today there's one ICD code for a sports injury that would be replaced by something like 39 different codes. There would be no diagnosis codes that would include it. You have to now tell whether you're struck by a baseball, a baseball bat, and so forth. Or you have to be able to say that this person was injured in my head. So it's a much more complicated. What we're asking for here, not to go ahead with this, but to give us a 5-year transition period instead of 2 years, because of the complexity of this, and we have to train doctors as to how to do this, otherwise, we will not be paid. So, in conclusion, the ACLA supports the Health Information Technology Promotions Act's new added safe harbors and stark law section, the bill's proposed preemption of state privacy laws, like the example that I gave. And the replacement of the ICD-9 code, but with a 5-year transition period. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. Vaughan.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, thank you for inviting us today. Consumers Union is an independent nonprofit publisher of consumer reports. And we don't just test toasters, we work on health issues and have a large article on this topic in Murchison. We strongly support the movement toward electronic health records as a way to improve quality and moderate health costs. But we believe that the American public will not fully support or fully use or fully benefit from the great potential of such systems unless more is done soon to ensure the privacy of medical information. As IBM's testimony just said, the privacy issues and the public's perceptions of those issues must be addressed in order for personal health records to succeed. Patients need meaningful control over their medical records, the right to keep the records private, and they should not be forced to give up privacy as a condition of treatment. We talk of consumer-directed healthcare, ownership society, personal empowerment. Mr. Stradek was talking about choice. The right to privacy is the heart of all of that. There must be a strong enforcement of privacy laws. If privacy is violated, people should be notified of that breach and given a private right of action. So Georgia is one of the states that allows that. The state should have the right to enact privacy laws above and beyond HIPAA's terribly minimalist provisions, in our opinion. Dr. Detmer's testimony has a deep point about how complex that could be, particularly if you look at Virginia, Maryland, D.C., or how would a computer keep track of all that. But rather than coming down to the federal level, could we work with the governors and the state legislators to say, what did the states feel they needed to do, and see if there was a model law that we could come up to rather than come down? Privacy needs to be strengthened, not weakened. We urge you to oppose legislation that would preempt stronger state laws or let HHS bureaucrats weaken the Fourth Amendment. And as we like to say, one size doesn't fit all. This is where we look at that. Tash started a set of consumer privacy principles on one statement that we hope you might look at as you consider legislation. Assuming we can get true privacy, we'd like to see quick dissemination of good systems. We recommend, however, against making broad exceptions to the anti-kickback and physician referral laws for donations. Given the federal budget situation, it's very understandable that people would look for a sort of free way to promote dissemination, like suspending these anti-fraud laws. We believe, however, that such action would have a very limited impact on the adoption of IT and would not be always good for consumers. This approach may not be free, it may have a cost. Basically, there's no free lunches in life. And I would bet you that Adam Smith would say most businesses don't give away something of value to another business unless they expect a return on the investment. When a hospital system offers an IT package to doctors, it hopes the ease of the communication between them and the goodwill generated by the gift will encourage referrals, regardless of whether that facility is the best quality or value facility for the patient. As a parallel example, in an area we know causes higher and more costly utilization, why do pharmaceutical companies give away free drug samples? It's because in our culture, the act of giving a gift, even a trinket, conveys a psychological sense of obligation, I owe you one. And That's human nature. In the case of free drugs, it leads to higher utilization of high-priced products. So please be skeptical. Companies, many for-profit, who spend 95% of the year telling Congress they're not paid enough by Medicare and Medicaid, they're all going broke. They have found some money that they now want to donate to a bunch of small businessmen making about $160,000 a year, who are very smart businessmen, but haven't been smart enough to realize they need to move to IT. It's kind of strange. I think it would increase care coordination under the right situation, but please be careful in how you draft this. We think there are better ways to encourage more adoption of IT that don't weaken the NFL laws. For example, you might explore with CBO whether, as you fix the Medicare doctor payment system in a budget-neutral, time-limited way, you could voluntarily encourage physicians to install certified IT by adjusting the practice expense payment and then collect it back at the end of the five-year cycle. Might be tough, but worth talking to CBO about. Representative Murphy's bill kind of gets into that a little bit in his Section 8. In conclusion, these anti-fraud laws are very delicate things, and we hope you'll be careful, as I know you will be. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Detmer. Chairman Dale and members of the Subcommittee, good afternoon. And on behalf of the Healthcare Leadership Council, thank you for the opportunity to testify before you this afternoon on the importance of health information technology and some of the important steps that need to be taken to create a national health information network. I'm here this afternoon wearing two hats, first as the chairman of the Healthcare Leadership Council, a coalition of many of the nation's leading healthcare companies and organizations. The HLC has a long-standing interest in this issue and shares the President's and this Congress's commitment to achieving widespread adoption of health information technology. But I'm also here today speaking as the President, Chief Executive Officer of Evanston Northwestern Healthcare, a large academic medical center in Northern Illinois, comprised of three hospitals and a 500 physician only specialty group practice and a medical research institute that has over $100 million in NIH grants. At our organization, the dream of electronic medical records is no longer a dream. It is a reality. For across all three of our hospitals and over 70 of our doctor offices and clinics, we've had a full electronic medical record up and running for over 2 years. And I can tell you that it is powerful and transformational and really makes the difference in the quality of care, in the reduction of medical errors, improvement of life for our nurses and our pharmacists and our staff, and improving the efficiency for all consumers. In 2003, we launched the EPIC, Comprehensive Electronic Medical Record System, that indeed provides all of our hospitals and physicians with a single, legible, unified source of clinical information. The healthcare professionals at Evanston can tell you firsthand with great confidence that health information technology can and must transform our nation's healthcare system for the better. We have been able to deliver medications to patients faster. We have significantly reduced medical errors. And in one specific example, when the manufacturer of Pyles took the drug out of commission, we were able to communicate and identify over 2,000 patients on the drug, communicate with their physicians and the patients, make changes to this drug in 3 hours. That would be impossible to achieve with paper records. The task before us is to make sure that this capability is available to all patients in the United States through interoperable electronic health records. And today I'd like to highlight 3 challenges that must be met in order to achieve this goal. First, we have to have a multi-state interoperable health information system that must have a uniform federal standard governing patient privacy. Our current confidentiality framework rests upon literally thousands of state statutes, regulations, common law principles, and advisories. Not only do states differ from each other in privacy rules, but virtually no state requirement is identical to the federal HIPAA privacy regulation. This checkerboard of varied rules will definitely stand in the way of an interoperable multi-state information network. To address this problem, we urge Congress to act on H.R. 4157, the Health Information Technology Promotion Act of 2005, which is co-sponsored by several members of the Subcommittee. This bill establishes a process to ensure a uniform national standard is achieved. The
that preserves or protects the security and confidentiality of patient health information. We believe this legislation is critical to achieving the nation's HIT objectives. Another challenge we face with such HIT financing. Developing the Epic system in Northwestern healthcare required over $40 million of investment, and our operating expenses initially went up by over $5 million per year to make sure that the system runs and runs well. Many healthcare providers, I would suggest, Mertz do not have the capital on hand to make this kind of investment, not only in our hospitals, but certainly in our physician offices. We believe that is in the nation's interest, given the importance of interoperable HIT to patient safety and the nation's emergency preparedness, to drive implementation through financial incentives and creative funding mechanisms. We are prepared to work to help you shape such an initiative. Finally, we believe that greater physician adoption is essential for electronic health records to occur in our hospitals and medical groups and to occur well. This will lead to greater integration of physician and hospital information systems as a result, better quality of care for patients, and saved lives. For this to happen, though, Congress needs to provide exceptions to the current physician self-referral prohibitions and anti-kickback rules, the rules that were not intended to prohibit the kind of beneficial patient-centered actions we're discussing today. Let me close, Mr. Chairman, by again thanking the subcommittee for spotlighting the vital importance of these issues. We look forward to working with you in the months ahead to bring advances in technology closer to the patients and families that we're privileged to serve. And we'll be very pleased to address your questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Pyles.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman. Pleased to be here. I'm Jeff Pyles, representing the American Psychoanalytic Association. And I'd like to just associate my remarks about this with the remarks of Mr. Vaughan, who expressed the concerns of consumers. And those are largely the same concerns by our members of the place. We've found that psychotherapists are especially the canaries in the coal mine when it comes to medical privacy. When there's a threat to medical privacy, you cannot provide effective psychotherapy. It just doesn't happen. I've also learned that working in this industry for about 15 years, and I found that there is absolutely no end to the number of people who want to eliminate your medical privacy and so they can help you. I would urge you to think carefully about that. The fundamental question I think we have to ask ourselves as we look at our IT system is, are we going to compel Americans to disclose all of their most sensitive health information about themselves and their families into or from a national interoperable health information system without meaningful informed patient consent, against our will, without adequate enforcement against unauthorized data uses and disclosures, and just essentially disregarding their views. One of the things I haven't heard much of in the testimony today is what do the patients want, and they won't be addressing them. I've learned that we've been working on this issue that if you have no privacy, you have no liberty. And if you have no privacy, we don't have access to effective health care. It just doesn't happen. If Americans don't have a right to privacy to their innermost thoughts and their genetic makeup, what possible privacy could they have? What other things could be private or more private than that? What does meaningful consent and privacy mean? What it means also means the ability of individuals to determine for themselves when, how, and what extent information about them is communicated. I think if you ask any person in the street, they'll have the same definition. Courts have said it really is essentially the right to control the disclosure of your information, at least in some routine circumstances. Why is the right so important? HHS concluded that, in short, the entire health delivery system is built upon the willingness of individuals to share the most intimate details of their lives with their health care providers. If that does not happen, an IT system is irrelevant. So that is the most significant concern when it comes to effective health care. HHS also concluded that unless prior public volunteers are laid, will be unable to obtain the full basket of an electronic health information system. And yesterday, former Speaker Newt Gingrich presented testimony before the Subcommittee of the Federal Workforce, and here's what he's had to say about the patient's right to control their information. consumers have the right to control and less than the ability to control who can access their personal information. Okay, I agree with Mr. Detmer. We know that we have sources already of national privacy statements. They appear in the Hippocratic Oath that dates back to the 5th century BC, which is administered by 90% of medical schools in this country to their graduates. We know that a state established standards set for the ethical practice of medicine, adopted by every segment of the medical profession, essentially assuring patients that their information won't be disclosed without their consent. AMA standards, for example, say, and I quote, the physician should not reveal confidential communications or information without the express consent of the patient and is otherwise required to do so by law. We also know that this right to privacy for personal information is a fundamental concept of our system of government. It is embedded in the 14th Amendment, the 5th, the 4th, and the 1st Amendments to the U.S. Constitution. This is the informational branch of the right to privacy, not the decisional branch where there is so much controversy. The Supreme Court is rock solid on protecting the right to informational privacy. And I say, consent must be voluntary and it must be informed. We also know that this right to privacy is grounded in the physician-patient privilege we're often recognized in most states, including your own. The psychotherapist-patient privilege is recognized in all 50 states of the District of Columbia and in federal common law. The right to privacy is also reflected in the tort laws, the statutory laws of all 50 states, and the states of Tennessee and California have the right to privacy in their state constitutions. We know also that the citizens of Georgia and the citizens of Ohio pretty keen about their right to privacy. And they have an act that they want the laws to specifically protect them. If you look at tab 2, which I won't be making, it lists the privacy laws in the state of Georgia that could be preempted by a bill such as H.R. 4157. Both of these states also recognize the private right of action, which HIPAA does not. There are many other states that recognize similar privacy protections in areas of mental health information, genetic testing information, cancer diagnosis and treatment information, HIV and AIDS, drug and alcohol abuse, diagnosis and treatment, birth defect, and many of these states give a private right of action. So I urge you to be very careful about any bill that would create these laws for the citizens of these states of something they need and want. There are many other privacy protections under state laws. 29 states now have breach protection, breach notification laws. I mentioned private rights of action are there. Let's look for a moment at the right of action and right of privacy under HIPAA. Now, the HIPAA privacy rule really should be in HIPAA disclosure rule because it provides regulatory permission for all covered entities and business associates to use and disclose identifiable health information for all routine purposes, defined as treatment, payment, healthcare operations, without the notice to the patient, without the patient's consent, over the individual's objection, even if the individual pays privately, and even retroactively at any time, even if information is created prior to the compliance date. Treatment, payment, healthcare operations, the reason for which this information can be disclosed without permission, is a lengthy list. If you look at tab 4, you will see that list of purposes. HHS responded to many of the concerns that the consumers had by adopting that regulation. But there was only a floor that still practitioners could still obtain consent. The more stringent laws remain in effect, and the ethical standards continue to bypass. We would argue that with any law that you have the obligation to preserve those protections. What does the public want and expect? If you look at HHS's findings, they found that the public has a common belief and strong expectation that their identifiable information will not be disclosed without their consent. 65% of Americans will not disclose sensitive information and necessary information to their physicians and providers if they thought it would go into an electronic record. 75% are concerned about the loss of medical privacy due to use of electronic information. And we know that this concern translates into adverse effects on healthcare. 600,000 people a year, according to HHS, 600,000 people a year do not seek early diagnosis and treatment for cancer. 2 million more annually do not seek medical treatment for mental illness. Thousands do not seek treatment for sexually transmitted diseases. 1 in 6 Americans take evasive actions to avoid privacy violations, including providing inaccurate changing physicians are avoiding healthcare altogether, and 87% of physicians report withholding information from the connection from a patient's medical record due to privacy concerns. So we would urge you to start this process with strong privacy protections. Also, we know that an IT system poses a greater threat to health information and privacy. The President's Information Technology Advisory Committee concluded that the nation's electronic information systems are highly vulnerable to corruption by hackers and others, that the threat is growing by 20% annually, and the increase in vulnerabilities cannot be addressed by current technology. Right now, to summarize really quickly, please, I will in conclusion, I'd just like to say that the right course of action for Congress to take, we believe, is around any health IT system in strong privacy protection reflected in the history of the nation, its medical and professional standards, the law of psychotherapy, patient privilege, and the Constitution's common law, providing for meaningful informed patient consent, providing a private right of action, and prompt notification for any breaches. Lastly, I would just mention the right to concern the loss of medical practice should be a particular concern for members of this body. Because in the Supreme Court's decision in 2001, right, Nikki versus Bopper, the court held that information about a public official or a public threat, which is obtained, even if it's obtained from a lawsuit, can be disclosed, can be published by the press, and the press has the First Amendment right to do it, and Congress cannot prevent that publication. So, we know these electronic information systems cannot be rendered secure. It is very likely that elections in the future are going to turn on what is in a politician's medical record as well as his currency rates. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I'm Don Detmer, President and CEO of the American Medical Informatics Association. There's 3,500 members, including physicians, nurses, other health professionals, computer and information scientists, and managers, biomedical engineers, academic researchers, and educators. Over the years, being those members have been the pioneers of information knowledge related to healthcare. In the early days of HIPAA rulemaking from 1996 to 1998, I served as a chair in the Ministry of Clean Health and Medical Statistics, and I also was a member of the Dialogue Committees that produced the AIDS report and the CASM report. More recently, I was one of the speakers to appoint the State Commission on Systemic Health for Dying. It's a pleasure to be before you today. I'd like to briefly summarize a few key points in my written testimony of the expanse of this to some extent. The need for federal leadership. Today, too few individuals have access to electronic health record systems, and there's no interconnectedness of the systems that exist. Yes, and yet, significant improvements in healthcare safety and quality can't be achieved without robust, secure electronic record systems. And that can be securely communicated across the national information network, as we hope in this community. Without federal leadership or a national role of safe, efficient, effective, equitable, timely, and patient-centered care, will remain a world field green because of necessary integrated health information system for my opinion. My comments will touch on a few points that are needed to move our national vision forward at this time. First, the Office of the National Coordinator for Health Information Technology, ONC, led by Dr. David Bayers, is doing an excellent job. HR 4157, the Health Information Technology Promotion Act, will establish the ONC in statute and annual policies. Second, the Department of Health and Human Services should be given explicit responsibility and sufficient ongoing resources for the National Library of Medicine to ensure that the ongoing maintenance and open dissemination of agreed health information and standards can be pursued, as Dr. Braithwaite mentioned. Similarly, we're pleased that HR 4157 provides explicit and reasonable rulemaking procedures for the Department to undertake long overdue upgrades of technical capabilities and classification systems. The U.S. must join the world in shaping global vocabularies and classifications as a source of primary data and electronic health records, including contemporary disease classifications and coding systems, specifically ICD-10, for a host of legitimate purposes that go well beyond reimbursement. Today, they just don't accurately reflect modern medical practice, nor do they help the needs of medical researchers. HIPAA. For my
perspective, as a physician, the privacy world has been largely successful in clarifying the individual rights of our patients in relation to their health care on a national basis and establishing the responsibilities and legal obligations of our providers to our patients in need. It's now time to take a rigorous look at the lessons learned. Some argue that states must have the capacity to enact more stringent requirements for privacy. In the name of better health and health care, I must respectfully disagree with that. I don't see how in practical terms we can get to the widespread adoption of electronic health records without establishing meaningful foreign ceiling standards that preempt and actually credit state approaches. Speaking realistically, only through federal and state leadership can we truly connect our nation for health care purposes. As a matter of fact, academia has supported the need for appropriate federal protection of genetic data. HR 4157 calls for a study of the impact of varying state statutes on the rights and protections afforded to patients and, importantly, on the impact of requirements on the quality, cost, and effectiveness of health care. A study of HIPAA privacy and security standards represents an absolute minimum. Two other items would be valuable to add to the study. First, in addition to the effects on care, the study should examine effects on legitimate biomedical research. And second, our patient genuinely needs a consistent way to reliably and accurately authenticate patient identity. Both safety and privacy are compromised when the right health information for one patient is associated with or sent to the wrong patient. Addressing dissociation and HIV dissemination. Reasonable safe harbors to prevent dissemination of health information technologies and services intended to improve health care quality, efficiency, and access would encourage the deployment of essential health information systems. And I'm very pleased that provisions to that effect are included in Chairman Doe's bill. Educating the workforce. Ultimately, health IT comes down to health care workers and patients being sufficiently skilled to take real advantages of the opportunities for improved care efficiency and access that health information technologies and interconnected national health information infrastructure can provide. In November 2005, the American Health Information Management Association, my organization, convened a workforce summit to develop initial strategies to address challenges related to effective implementation of electronic health records and personal health records. The resulting white paper, building the workforce for health information transformation, presents 9 primary recommendations that key stakeholders, including government, can use to support the existing workforce and ensure that sufficient numbers of well-qualified health information specialists are available to achieve the necessary health transformation through IP. The commandments report to you and if anything will stand ready to help address this challenge. I firmly believe that the development and deployment of an interoperable, interconnected national health information system is not purely a health care issue. It's a matter of national security. When we face God forbid an unmarked betrayal, or an outbreak of alien flu humans, or another episode of bioterrorism, we simply must have a reliable health information and communication system for our people's well-being. Our nation's safety depends on it. Thank you, Dan, for the opportunity to testify and look forward to responding to questions.
Thank you very much. Thanks for all those very interesting comments. I think with maybe one exception, Mr. Pyles being the exception, most of you have agreed we need to do something in this area. Mr. Vaughan has some reservations about it. I understand the privacy issue, and I certainly agree with it. But hearing that some of the testimony sort of reminds me of the old joke about the fellow who went to his doctor, and he's, the doctor asked him, says, well, what's wrong with you? And he says, that's what I'm paying you for. We all want to protect our privacy, but there has to be some degree of sharing of that. And I think that the question of preemption of state law is one of the more significant issues that we have to deal with here. I understand, too, that there are some very pragmatic problems when you allow states to have their own separators, like congressional district borders, 3 states. And the Chattanooga area is my immediate north of my district. We have doctors who have patients that go to the hospitals in Chattanooga or other parts of my state, of course, Augusta, which is on the South Carolina border, Columbus, which is on the Alabama border. If we don't have some degree of uniformity of those kinds of regulations,
statutorily, how do we avoid, if nothing else, those cross-state dealings back and forth, like the hospital and doctors who may be in different states? How do we avoid those kind of problems? So where one state's rules may be different from the other state's rules. Is that a problem, or is that not a problem?
Mr. Pyles? I'm glad you addressed that. I don't necessarily, I don't disagree that something needs to be done in the chairman. I think something needs to be done, particularly with respect to HIPAA, because HIPAA authorizing disclosure for treatment and healthcare operations in your state, and most others, standards of medical ethics prohibited it. So it causes confusion in the consumer community that are not there right to price or not confusion in the practitioner community. I think that's a good argument for having greater uniformity and therefore understandability and privacy standards across the country.
Shouldn't we be able to agree on what those would be?
I would agree with that, because that's why I cited the standards of medical ethics which apply across the country and contain a consistent privacy standard that's been applied for years. I cited the constitutional common law implied in every state. Psychotherapist patient privilege and patient physician privilege, which again applies across the state. But what we are suggesting is let's look at the common standards we now have that apply across the country, all three of the states here, district boards. Every doctor in the state is subjected to the standards of medical ethics. Everyone is subject to the constitutional common law on physician patient privilege. We have national standards, the privacy. We just don't have the framework.
Mr. Vaughan, you made reference to the fact of possible model law. Is there one that has been proposed by the National Association of State Legislators, for example?
Not to my knowledge, I just read Don's testimony. This is a problem, and how do we deal with it? And it strikes me that there's leadership you could call for the NPA and the National Conference of State Legislators to come together and to really identify where are the differences and where is the commonality? And like when you make a change in long-term care insurance, you give the AIC a couple of years to come up with a model rate and stuff, and then it goes into effect, you could set up a structure that kind of bring the states together and say, what's really important to us? And let's try to talk a common language and not this Tower of Babel. And you got a couple of years to do it, guys, but to that is such detailed work. You don't put this all on your desk, I would think. You can get these groups together and see where the commonality lies, and let's try to bring this up for the American public rather than down to a pretty low minimum.
Mr. Rich.
Mr. Chairman, I just wanted to comment. We think that the HIPAA standard does create some uniformity. The weakness of it is that it does not permit these literally thousands of state conflicting rules that are creating an obstacle. And the example I gave you were various states actually borrowed the laboratories for providing lab results. If you set up regional organizations or web-based electronic health record, under the state laws that exist today, we could not transmit laboratory results, which make up 60% of someone's medical record. We could not. The medical record that's on the way would be missing 60% of the data that a physician needs. And so we think that the HIPAA standard is a very good one and very protective and sets the standard. And we believe that the connection of this, you're only doing a study, which I think would hopefully identify these conflicting state laws. To have the states go back and try to clean their laws as well, we're doing a study of state laws. There are thousands and thousands and thousands of rules. It would take 100 years for the states that we gravel on those. That's why we need one good, strong, common standard.
My time is expiring, Mr. Weissman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Following along the state of inquiry, I am concerned about creating a national health information infrastructure without strong privacy protections for patients. HIT will allow providers to keep their patients' health care records electronically and share them with others more easily. I don't presume that any of you would be comfortable letting an employer or a health plan know if you were genetically predisposed to being around, so that the public know their grandchild had been exposed to AIDS, or allow a coworker to learn that your husband or wife has a fertility problem. This clearly are very private matters. With the expansion of the use of electronic medical records comes an increase the potential for breaches of privacy and the pirating of sensitive personal medical information by unauthorized parties. And HIPAA, as the transportability account, set minimum federal standards for use and disclosure of personal information. However, when HIPAA was passed, Congress was unable to come to agreement in certain areas, so states were allowed to enact additional consumer protections. Similarly, Congress has been unable to come to agreement and pass a federal genetic non-discrimination law prohibiting employees from learning about and using genetic information about their employees in the workplace. Still, some HIT proponents would be comfortable with HIPAA as a federal privacy standard that would also preempt all state privacy and security laws, such as state genetic non-discrimination laws. So, Mr. Pyles, could you comment on what would have to be included in a federal privacy law for this to be protected, especially if it were to supersede state laws?
Thank you. I'd be glad to do that. First and foremost, I think we would want to see a law grounded in the principles, as I said, of standard of medical ethics. Otherwise, we would have Congress perhaps authorizing an ethical code of disability, so we cannot take a position of law to say, happen or any practitioner. It ought to be granted the right grounds to reflect it in our founding principles of the Constitution. And again, those are remarkably similar. There's a comment about thousands of state laws. In fact, there are core concepts in those laws that are remarkably similar. As I said, every state protects health information, recognizes psychotropic special privilege. But beyond that, we would need things that HIPAA does not provide, things like breach notice requirements where patients whose privacy has been breached will be notified and the secretary will be notified so that we can see a list of companies that don't do a very good job of protecting medical privacy. That could probably be the best enforcement measure we could have. There should be a private right of action that every state recognizes because we know that HIPAA, HHS has done a very poor job. There's over 17,000 privacy complaints have been filed since April 14, 2003, with the implementation of the HIPAA, and only one enforcement action. So we think that there should be an opportunity for patients to establish electronic black boxes. We don't think IT and privacy are incompatible. We think you can actually enhance privacy through the use of health IT, but you need to establish the principles at the beginning.
With some states, the overall waste personal health information can be used without consent. Many states have more protective laws about specific types of sensitive information that HIV has. You mentioned public health records, genetic tests, and more. And many states have more meaningful consent requirements. These are the kinds of things you think ought to be in a federal law for protection.
I would support maybe perhaps a study done by the Secretary of HR 4157 provides. But it would have to be a study that is first and foremost directed to identify the commonalities that we see across the country in medical ethics and in state laws and constitutional law. We should build on the foundations we have and we've formed in this country. We should not try to assume that we have to operate with a blank slate.
The federal law directly applies to providers, health plans, and health clearinghouses. Many states' privacy laws directly apply to a broader range of individuals and entities, like those that transcribe records and those that copy and transport files. Do you think that ought to be a federal
law? Yeah, absolutely, Mr. Congressman. HIPAA doesn't apply to hackers. Unless they happen to be providers, I'm sure you know what's been clear. So
No place wasn't clear that we do need to fix those problems. The records are in the ICU. It walks through there, the place is ruined, and will be ruined for the rest of our natural lifetimes. Contrast that with the bragging library in Marina, Dallas, Texas, where you had 400 private doctors show up to pre-op people that didn't get off the buses from the Superdome. And they had, I remember the drugstore precisely, I think it was Walgreens, set up one of their remote computer terminals there. They had medical records producing a pharmaceutical information on a lot of people that got off the buses. And that PCP of the medical story a lot more straightforward. So the value was proven to be that day. But it is it's a difficult claim. Richard S. Thanks, wondering if you had a thought as to how much, looking forward, how much is this likely to cost if we just look at the federal government component of healthcare, Medicare, Medicaid, VA, federal prison system, Indian health service, federal qualified health service, about 50% of healthcare expenditures are accounted for by the federal government. Do you have an idea as to what it's going to cost Secretary Levin when he says he's going to build this platform?
Yeah, I can't give you a specific number. I can't say that some of the building blocks that have been put in place, in fact, by Dr. Brayden, if you take the actual proposal, for example, essentially, the one record of venture capitalists would be when you're trying to invest in investment, you didn't return on that investment. All of that may have been about $1 billion investment of his part spread across four major corporations. I could tell you, for a company like IBM, we're taking that and we're starting to build on it. At the end of the day, I suspect that we will probably invest 10 to 20 times that amount in the open effects of healthcare problems as a part of our replicated the opportunity that he's provided us across this country. So, basically, without necessarily having a number of the national federal government itself has to invest, but that private enterprise is going to go a lot of ways and that can solve the problem.
You know, when I think back to my days in practice, it is a big expense for a single physician's office to do this. If a hospital puts in an expensive system, they, of course, have borne the cost of that. Then to bring individual doctor's offices on board would be a relatively inexpensive process because most of the software expenses have already been handled. But if the doctor's offices then have to individually go out and contract with the software licenses and what have you, it does become a bit more expensive. So, you know, I wonder if there's any way to, if there are thoughts in there, how we might reform some of the stark laws to allow this to be a more facile process.
Comments are, I think, absolutely on track in terms of the relative cost and the ability of extending from the hospital systems to the doctor offices. In our own experience for our three hospitals, I mean, we invested a little bit over $40 million to get the system up and running. In our experience, it takes, on an incremental basis, approximately $1,500 per physician to incrementally bring additional doctors up on the system. So it is a rather large expense. It's also a time-consuming expense. We are inhibited from the start of the year kickback provisions from extending our system to other physicians who are independent or private practice. And that's a big compound risk that we want to take, given the penalties here involved with those surgeons. So it would be a relatively easy thing to extend the systems and the software to other physicians if we're permitted to do it under the start regulations.
The
$50,000 certainly is potentially able to put that in perspective. You know, our data shows that, you know, that would represent the cost, the actual market pricing, and what physicians are willing to bear, the cost of the actual willing to pay. It's probably more than $300 to $400 per doctor per month, maybe. So there's a bit of a gap there between what the cost is and what the delivery is. Of course, with the AI, most of the services, they don't necessarily have to go out and buy
quick panel, and we will represent the lawyers in your room. How many people are the folks I'd look around your time? If you get a second round, I'll be happy to come back to you. From a physician's perspective, too, it is also a question of time for us to know the chronic prescribing or even electronic medical records. An average physician has to see between 30 and 50 patients a day in order to pay the overhead and take something on. And if you add a minute and a half to 2 minutes to every transaction in order to be up to date with electronic medical records or prescribing, that's 2 hours. And how are we going to compensate the physician for that time?
We actually have broken into this right now. North of the Westchester County, North of the University City, 60,000 of the employees. The HR department might be actually providing incentives to the physicians to the tune of 50 cents per member per month to actually use the systems to so they get paid, in order to get the quality benefits, the cost benefits, and whatnot, on a minimum level of adoption. ROI estimate was less than 2 years. We're seeing much higher level adoption on that than you would expect it, but it's a great model, I think, that we could use, of course, other endeavors like this. And I agree 100% with your comments on kind of doctors.
But there are insurance plans where some of that makes sense to bring to incentivize the doctors to
probably need to keep in mind that a great deal of benefit in terms of these systems goes back to the employee and to the doctor.
Sure. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms.
Couch. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have about 4 or 5 questions I'm going to try to get into the first time, so maybe ask them for just brief responses. Mr. Nelson, I'll start with you. We've been hearing from others on the panel about the complexity of multiple state privacy laws. I wanted to know, technologically, can you speak to the capability of the technology to accommodate different state privacy laws?
Technology can handle it. We've had experience with ATM, the banking industries, all of which have their own accreditatory issues.
So that's not the issue. But then let me talk about privacy, and I guess I'll address you, Mr. Pyles, but I don't care who jumps in. Under current legislative proposals, do patients have to consent to having anonymous information shared with researchers? They have to get that approval.
I'm sorry, can you restate the question?
Under current legislative proposals, or at least some of them, do patients have to consent, consent to, in writing, to having anonymous information shared with researchers?
Well, if it's anonymous, I don't know about pending legislation. If it's de-identified information, it certainly could be disclosed under HIPAA without
the knowing.
If
it's anonymous, correct.
Under the proposed legislation, I can't think of any of the proposed legislation
that didn't legislation. The way it is now, then, who's responsible for determining whether this is legitimate? If lines have been crossed, if there's been boundaries pending proposed legislation.
Under HIPAA, it's very, very difficult for a patient to know that their information has been disclosed, and therefore, since they get no consent, no opportunity, so that in effect is no notice. So I'm stunned that there are 17,000 complaints that it's adjusted to see it, because I don't know how those patients would have done it. So there must be many thousands or tens of thousands more breaches of privacy that are out there that people would object to if they just knew about it, but they probably don't.
And they don't know about it. In some of the proposed legislation, is this dealt with?
No, that's one of the things most disturbing about all of the legislative proposals I see. It seems that privacy is always the last issue to be discussed. If it's discussed at all, a number of the proposals don't mention anything about privacy.
They don't privacy at all.
Correct.
Well, that's something I would hope that, given the questions today, that certainly is on our minds. And we reflect our constituents, so I'm hopeful that this will be interjected into any kind of studies. And Mr. Chairman, I would hope that would be the case. I'm wondering now, with a little more time that I have, if you, Mr. Pyles, or anyone could comment on some of the shortcomings in federal law currently with regard to enforcement of the federal uses of personal health information. You touched on it a bit like that. But the disparity is that are there states that do a better job?
States can do a better job. Even with the authorization for disclosure without consent, the HIPAA also means that patients often can't even assert the rights they have under state law, because many states prohibit the disclosure of much or many types of information. But HIPAA allows the disclosure of someone just simply the practitioner
surface bit rates plus, so HIPAA requires a notice of privacy practices to be given to every individual. And the notice compels the practitioner to describe the disclosures that are made under HIPAA authorized to be HIPAA, even if that's not their practice. So they're supposed to include also notice on rights for patients that are under state laws, but I've seen very few notices that include any reference to state rights.
Is there a way that Mr. Nelson is looking at, as the standard says, that there's no barrier in the technology for allowing?
I had total confidence in Mr. Nelson. Mr. Congress said that the national privacy standard had to reflect the right to privacy in the medical ethics constitutional law and law of privilege of tomorrow morning. Mr. Nelson would have a product on the street that did just that. And that also accounted for variations in state laws.
And accounting for the issues of state law. So there really there is nothing that should say that way this being pursued in the interest of the consumers or the corporations.
Well, I'm not going to
I'd like to hear from the rest of the
record, but I'm sure. And whether it's a technological barrier, and as an example, I do think it's definitely a barrier to state laws. I mean, an example, if you fly in Georgia,
the laws do not allow the laboratories to transmit results to an electronic health record, to reveal if there's a disease management program that's been mandated in Medicare, we can't transmit them because they forbid us giving the transmitted lab results to anybody except the ordering physician. Even with the patient's consent, we cannot provide lab results for disease management, for electronic health record. So, in other respect, maybe they could build a computer that could do it, but we can't transmit the results. So, That's a step there, and I think it's absolutely insurmountable for us in this program.
That would be a very remarkable state law, not only the story of the state, but I'm not going to run it. I seen the paper about the Georgia
program.
Well, I know one thing, it's true that Georgia can't run it, but the problem is that Georgia can't run it.
It's not remarkable there because it's a thing about there are dozens of states that have these laws, so it's not unusual at all, Mr. Chairman.
I think that the one of the really strong points is that you do have any stuff, and I think that will be an excellent thing for me. That's why, in fact, I really am so supportive of your big problem. So,
Mr. Chairman, this has been a good thing. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Mr. Brayton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Having served for 3 years in the legislature before I told you about last night when I came to Congress, I'm surprised a lot of states have said that we're going to prohibit the individual patient from receiving that information.
It's as far as Arizona state law that actually prohibits the patient from having access to their own records, which we find kind of odd. And again, one of the labs we can be testing, and it's not our business is really to get the data back to the physician, but there's so many important things, I mean, diabetes management, and they need to get H1C tests every 6 months. I mean, we have almost 10,000 people die a year just because they're not tested for their hemoglobin regularly. So these programs are so important to save people's lives, or cholesterol, people with heart disease. It's essential that these programs be able to manage their disease. And so that's why we're very careful. We don't want to give results out to everybody. Genetic tests, we're the people who do the genetic tests. We certainly don't want to send those out to anybody who doesn't have an absolute report. But in limited areas where we need it for disease management, hemoglobin, diabetes, asthma, and heart disease, yes, those are important tests, but we'll be careful about it.
Mr. Bond, do you have a response to that?
We're very much for consumers being able to have access to their medical records, and if there's an error in there, ask for an edit and a correction. Yes, this is the kind of thing that we need to work out.
Can you tell me on the front, does Texas have that prohibition?
I didn't look at Texas specifically. I know that Georgia, Florida, New York, California do have, and I'd have to get back to you on that.
Well, we can check, but okay.
So generally, what the state law says is that the ordering physician or his or her designee may get the lab results, and unfortunately, it's been interpreted to mean the designee is only somebody in the doctor's office can get the results. So generally, almost in every state, we cannot report to a real or to a disease management organization. So I'm not
because that's a concern, right? Because I have to pitch you on to make that decision. Mr. Bowen, you give some examples of concern about the abuses on this side, and I can't be positive. And Dr. Brown just talked about the power of the warrior, just talking about some of the things we have to do to be able to protect how our physicians' choices influence and patients affected now on some of the
to deal with the fact that it has a lot started with labs that doctors who invested in a lab, everybody who walked in, maybe just GMI pregnant would get a full lab workup. And there was just documentation by GAO and OIG, a tremendous over-utilization and everything was adding x-rays and MRI machines and so forth. And it spread the tribes and get the was meant to be able to bright line because the kickback laws, they have to prove intent. This was meant to be a bright line to say, gee, people who make these investments or get remuneration tend to, whether they're aware of it or not, tend to start overordering. They start doing more of a particular service and it's driving up costs something awful. And so the worry is that if stuff is provided free, or you're straight to a doctor, it makes you a good friend of that person who gave it to you, and you tend to gravitate that way. And maybe that isn't the best place to send your patient. And so that's what we're trying to be careful about, opening that door to overutilization or misapplication of medicine. It's important to coordinate care, goodness yes, but how about making that part of pay for performance? Finding other ways to coordinate the care.
One of the suggestions, we're having enough trouble dealing with our lobbying before, but just looking too much at the physician's situation. But on the electronic records technology, and that's something that isn't obviously a great idea, not that a doctor having the immediate access to the test, but if we're looking at the group as a whole, is there a way that we can draft something that we're trying to actually have that, maybe we would not run afoul of those, whether it's IBM or whoever is selling this equipment, that they don't know, beside that is the one. So I know one of the suggestions I heard is that, for example, for the greater good, we might want to have some nonprofit, maybe the medical society, in a given community or state to say, this is the depository, this is the information in any way you can remember about this physician, for example, could be access that without someone feeling like maybe they're utilizing that.
A way to deal with it, you wouldn't have to change any laws or get any IG opinions, is if people have somebody and they want to encourage the spread of this technology to doctors in the state who maybe don't have the resources or are behind the eight ball on it, give it to a foundation. Robert Wood Johnson was upstate foundation, and they would get out the money. I think you'll find a lot of opposition or objections to that idea, and that should tell you something. The people who want to give this hardware and software, they want a tie with that doctor. They want a tie that binds so that doctor will send patients to that hospital. Coordinating care with the patients is great, but it's that hospital that gives the data or software. Is it the best place for that patient?
I still have a comment. If you, Mr. Chairman, if you allow me to say anything else on the panel, I'd like to explain.
Yes, I just want to make way out on this. Right now, our biggest challenge in the U.S. is particularly the small provider office. That's really our biggest challenge. The hospitals, frankly, are getting there and are building these systems. The thing is, our country is in a very complex and large place. And I think some of these issues are working, do work, and can still work, and will work in some settings. But in other settings, that opportunity, that kind of option, is just maybe it will be very hard to put in play. And I think what we're really advocating for, if we can get the regulations right for security and those kinds of design features, that our feeling is to have this connectivity means that actually the doctor in West Bicycle, Texas, can call it easily in concert with the Mayo Clinic, electronically as easy as they can actually to the provider that maybe didn't make connection. And
neutral fact is that exactly our current dividend really has significant options in terms of these arrangements we might make. So I'd like to think you could craft, or certainly look at your craft, because I think we need to thank Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
I believe we'll start somewhere.
Let me start with, I'm going to try to simplify because I think I'm in rather simplistic terms in terms of the problems I see in Canada. First of all, with regard to a hospital sharing its software with physicians, virtually all of my physicians practice in only one hospital. It doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me that they should not have some way when the patient goes to the hospital. Instead of asking the patient when he goes back to the doctor's office, well, what did they tell you? So it reminds me of a story one of my clients. I asked him one time, I said, well, what did the doctor tell you? He said, I have no idea. I don't think he spoke English. We've got to have a better way of transmitting information that helps the patient. The one situation that the hospital sharing what their tests were, what their findings were, that way the treating physician, he needs to know that. Also, let's suppose there's a consult with a specialist in the same community who does something. He prescribes some medication. Instead of a patient then going back to his primary doctor and being asked, well, what did he give you? Well, I don't really know. What did he tell you? I'm not really sure. I didn't understand it. There has to be a better way of doing this. Now, there are several things that pop up to me as a major problem we'll talk about, we've alluded to in some of your testimony. One is the coding. And whether we're talking about ICD-9 versus the ICD-10, and Mr. Mertz alluded to some of the potential problems with the additional codings that are there. Let's talk about that for just a minute. How many of you believe we should go to a broader coding, such as the ICD-10, would anybody care to comment? He is actually a fellow of sports medicine, she's talking about some of the sports issues. And I practiced surgery, vascular surgery, as well as sports medicine for about 25 years. And for 15 years, I did have published a fair amount of work that was internationally verified as being valid. To this day, the coding works for even diagnosis that I made in athletes, sometimes Olympic athletes, still doesn't exist in this scenario. As well as being able to, so for payment purposes, I have to find a code that's sort of related to the landing. But in actual fact, what works for Melanie really doesn't capture what you really need to really try to do research as well as you just talked about, for example, asthma today doesn't have a lot of the codes in mind that really are it. So there's a shortage. We don't know precisely how sick they are in some of the ways because it's very hard to track down. But suffice to say that there are a lot of progress in medicine in 23 years. And that's how we move the coding system. So, yes, it does create problems. We know that not only need to worry about that, but we need to put in, that's why I talked about the national libraries, we need to put in this process that can keep that going over time so that we don't have these very tough dislocations. And the team is saying, yes, we really need a plan process, something that will catch us up, but that will hopefully keep us back. Ms. Branch, yes, Ms. Branch, we have that. ACL, the lab, we support moving to the ICD-10. But I just, my personal headline from 12,000 to 13,000 codes to 120,000 codes, so it's 10 times as complex. You know, I recall that we're just now, after 4 or 5 years, adjusted to the HIPAA transaction codes, the new claim standards, it took us years to get that. That was much less complicated to look into this. We almost had a train wreck where providers were going to get paid by payers because of the complexity. And so we just want to make sure as we move to this, 2 years is not enough. We need to take at least 5 years to train the people in these systems. We have to train all of the doctors who submit the diagnosis to us, they're going to have to put 8 or 10 times as much information on the form that the doctor sends to the lab. If they don't put, if every T isn't crossed and every I isn't dotted, we don't get paid. We perform the tests, we don't get paid, and the system will really shut down. So just I would urge some caution in the moment of transition
experience so that we can go back.
Mr. Chairman, I think that the systems that the electronic health record systems today are based on those coding systems. We didn't get paid for practicing medicine when we said medicine in code. The problem is that those codes are very burdened and very general, and that they're really reflective. Dr. Butler said, what is actually done to the patient? And if we can't come up with a coding system that's detailed enough, so that what we record in our electronic health systems actually represents what's done to the patient, then we can't even look forward to that meeting that I put forward about how we can practice medicine better in the future by actually having computers help us to interpret what those codes mean with respect to the rest of the data about that patient. And not necessarily as an ETA, so that CT is a very sure coding system, for example, that has that level of clinical information. And as we implement electronic health record systems, we now have computers to help us to come up with the right code. It doesn't have to be done manually. It would work with pen and paper as it is done now in most places for SAP. So I think there's a good balance to
be. Yeah, and also mentioned the importance of the patient being an explainer. And if you have terminology where the patient can see some of these codes, it really comes around and reflect particularly what happened. And it really helped bring that patient in and that care.
Thank you again. And you're talking about barriers of some type, but maybe we need to pursue that. I want to ask the question that you started, Mr. Chairman, but I want to see about HIT implementation, what barriers there might be there, and I'll continue with you, Dr. Braithwaite. Everyone seems to agree that adoption of electronic health records and a move toward interoperability would allow different providers, health plans, labs, and others to talk to each other. And that's a good thing, would improve quality, save resources, and eliminate harmful errors. Yet a recent RAND study found only about 20 to 25% of hospitals and 15 to 20% of physicians' offices have an HIT system. Talk a little bit more. I know we've brought this up, but focusing on barriers to implementation. If we design some legislation, we're going to hopefully have a study, but should we do or could we do that we might help them pass some of those barriers? And anyone else could jump in as well.
Well, as I mentioned, one of the major barriers is the incentive system. We are reimbursed in the system for peace work.
Right.
We're not reimbursed for the health of the patient. And so coming up with several different mechanisms to incent the appropriate implementation of health information technology and the clinical practice would be appropriate, I think. In surveys that we've done, people have problems with upfront funding, as has been discussed. The capitalization of medicine in practices that don't really have that much capital is difficult. And coming up with changes in the reimbursement policies so that, for example, a patient performance program under Medicare that actually paid for improved outcomes of the patient based on the data that's produced for the electronic health system would in fact encourage the physicians to get information technology to the clinics and provide higher quality care as long as the result was that the interaction went down because of these strange reimbursement policies that come out sometimes. I think a lot of incentives so that the people who purchase the systems and the people who benefit from them are appropriately aligned with the implementation of health information technology would be.
As I mentioned in my statement, some of our national labs, they are connected with about 50% of the physician offices. And the figure that was given is right, it costs $30,000 to $50,000. Create this kind of activity with the physician office, not just the hardware and the software, with the training, it's marrying all the different systems. It's extremely complicated. And half of the offices that we don't have relationships tend to be the smaller practices where they don't have the resources to do it. The labs, we've been the ones who invested millions and millions of dollars that pay for this kind of activity. And when you get to a small physician office, and they don't have the volume of lab tests to make it economical for the labs to make a $50,000 investment so that they can grow the results. You know,
their case to get the results electronically. So that's, I think, one of the key areas where help is needed to provide incentives and resources. You know, we don't get paid, we get paid for doing the test. We don't get paid for spending $50,000 to look them up electronically. So that's where we need some help.
Programs kind of spectrum, so that it's done it. Half the data issues we have to finance it, where to find the money to do it. The other half relate to huge behavioral changes for electronic medical records in the hospitals and the doctor's offices, which behavior changes by who? Everybody, every clinician, every nurse, certainly a physician, every technologist. That's the electronic medical records system must change the way they practice. It's no longer writing things out by hand or trying to decipher the physician's handwriting. Everything changes, and for the most part, it changes for the better.
Like when you mentioned, say, like that you mentioned incentives, voluntary, is that sufficient? I mean, with the ones who would design registration, is it significant enough for our national interest to mandate some things, or are we even to the point of talking about that?
In the provider side, the hospitals and the physicians, there's a great lack of really trust that there's going to be anywhere near the sufficient level of funding to bring doctor offices and hospitals up when we're facing another $36 billion in Medicare cuts. So there's going to have to be, again, some kind of opportunity, including in the private sector, to invest monies to make this a real reality, unless the Congress wants to take out a project like rebuilding the federal highway system for hundreds of billions of dollars to really make this a reality in the near future. And then, back up to you on that, I think that the thing that's tension in this is it is a lack there is the EHR system.
Right.
And in fact, that's a very good status there. So that in fact, if you go for the EHR light, in other words, the cheapest kind of way to just get something in, you don't have the decision support infrastructure where you really get your economy safety and by one practice, if you're willing, you can find the scratch to get four times more, you'll get 12 times back. So it's not like it's just sort of a thing to do. So education change management, major piece of this, and like other thing that I have one kind of growth plan that I mentioned earlier, I guess my yes to with authentication. It was interesting today that the commission report on systemic interoperability put out this on that commission. We had a patented app for it, and then the same afternoon we had a presentation of some of the folks who were on this commission and talking about it. But one thing in the audience said, I have a problem for you. She says, I'm Mary Smith. I have a problem with authentication.
Right.
And she says, I get other people's bank statements when I do online banking. I need some unique way. Both from my perspective, there's not for everybody else to identify me there. So this issue of being able to have at least a national way of unique identifying folks is really something that is a barrier that, again, I think is a federal issue that people can address.
Thank you. I kind of overstate my time, but this is our second lesson. I started out by talking as a nurse about patient safety and the benefits that I've had to. Somewhere in our study, I would hope we could find some way of demonstrating that in the long run, though initial outlays will be significant of resources, there ought to be a payback to society, at least for morbidity rates dropping, mortality rates dropping. Can we get to that? Is that can the study even demonstrate something?
Our studies, we can tell you that right now, it doesn't take a long term. We've shown in our studies, in our hospitals, our doctor offices, there is a payback, economic, clinical, it works. It absolutely works.
And is there demonstration of that already?
In our system, yes. And speaking of the nurse in the education channel, the strategy we really need is educating nurses in particular.
Well, I'm going to look at that doing all of this. But a fair amount of it in the system.
If I might still like great ways to handle it too.
I should say,
for care in our studies, we save 20% of the nurses' time instead of babysitting the child and trying to decipher the doctor's handwriting.
I mean, you're all talking about acute care, probably. But look at long term care and who delivers that care and who has to take a huge chunk out of every hour of patient care to Dr. Mayer's
law.
It's time for the doctors, isn't it? Thank you.
Not much. You know, I think back over 25 years of medical
Professor Pyles was to work, so you know, I interrupted you before, and maybe let you finish what you were trying to tell me about the structures. The Pyles trying to make it eventually bad, which was that it was a sizable investment, $50,000 or so, to set up that connectivity between the labs and the physician offices. It's going to take up a lot of money in the labs to make that investment. And I just want to remind you, we very much support the way the Stark Law in many ways, because it does not allow the abuses that happened many years ago. We're able to only provide the equipment that's needed just very narrowly to monitor tests and report the results. So, but we see the need to expand a little bit to allow more investment in IT. We just want to make sure that we're still included in the exemption, but then start carefully. So I appreciate the opportunity to finish up. Thank you. Mr. Vaughan, on that, does it ever increase the cost of care to manage your information?
Sure.
I can tell you that in my hometown of Denver, Texas, I encountered that situation every day when I got to hospitals that competing at the bottom of the day, not communicating with each other, just effectively communicating with each other. So a CAT scan in one hospital on a Friday night, and then to get a CAT scan in the next hospital, if you go into the other emergency room on the next Friday night, because you didn't like the care you're going across town. So it is a system that creates more expenditure, I believe, by not communicating.
Well, absolutely. I mean, we need to communicate. This is where so much of the savings would be. But how you get this information, software, hardware, into doctors' offices, how can we do it where it doesn't lead to some distortions that we might not even see for a while, where one hospital has got good cash flow in a year, the other one's been doing charity care, might be a little starved, this one donates some stuff, and just consciously or unconsciously, doctors will say, I like those guys, they've been helping me, they've been helping my office. I move my patients to, and I may not have the best department or anything. So you get those goofy, almost unconscious distortions. Can't we pay for this up front? And I know the federal budget situation, never mind. There's no cash.
Or Mr. Neaman is not the savings for us in the Medicare. Is that what you just told us a minute ago?
Our system is.
Yeah. So how much money are you going to save us? If the chairman and I are successful at getting this your company, the one that gets the contract, are we going to say that's our $4 billion of Medicare this year that we can then turn back over?
I can only comment on our system that we've actually found. Even if you set aside things like saving human lives and doing things like the point being is that the systems that we've experienced really do save lives, and they do less testing, not more testing. They protect patients from abuses of testing. We've even shown in our studies that the efficiency improves so much that we were able to save cost-wise $17 million a year in our system by doing things right the first time, not having to do it time and time and time again. So there is a small incremental savings once you get the system up and running. Again, one of the other benefits are tremendous. I think Mr. Vaughan's examples might be a little confused with what the real issues are here. In the examples of over-testing, such as too many lab tests or too many x-rays when a physician owns that equipment, that's not what we're talking about here. If you want to preclude that, then don't let physicians own MRI machines. Well, another issue. What we're talking about here,
not a good idea, by the way, but
I wasn't advocating it, but as a principal, particularly by what the data surgeons would let me know about that. But what we're talking about here is the sharing of data. And shouldn't we be focused on the patient here? To share that data between our hospitals and our physicians, doesn't the American public expect our hospitals and doctors to work together around the central point of data? The answer is quite clear in our experience, absolutely yes.
Mr. Pyles, this is what I haven't wanted to get this in to ask a question in the last round, and I think it touches on what you're asking there. How much is saving I think is going to be going to need? The numbers I've seen on the cost of running the country for health IT are $176 billion initially in startup upfront costs and $46 billion annually. Now, keep in mind, if you have to replace an information system, it otherwise spends about
that's a big chunk. I mean, his share of that was a big chunk. He was chosen actually at one or two main positions in Maryland to use a electronic information system that we cross. He's not even, he's out of order, he's chosen out of box, he's put in for information. He can't communicate with the system at least about 3 times a day. And the information that gets back is oftentimes so bright that he can't understand it. So he's a little frustrated. So I think one of the, I've heard the other healthcare is the last area where we don't have IT. It may not be such a bad thing because we're dealing with people's lives. They wouldn't impose a drug or a procedure on the public unless it's proven safe and effective for patient use. So I just urge you to be careful. If, as a lawyer, one of the questions I've always tried to what is the standard of care for the electronic health information system? When you go into the hospital and a patient has a seizure, you punch the screen to get the patient's current status and what their options are, so it's denied the patient and prescribed certain patient values. What is the standard of doing that? Again, it's not to figure it out. Was for you negligent? Was the hospital negligent? Was it expected for the system to be down once a week, once a month, once a year? My computer is down minimum of twice a week. Maybe the system is wondering, but that's a whole area that's completely exploded as far as I can tell. I don't see any standard of care like a Xerox standard. Xerox will tell you, here's a copy of the show, let me down in 4 hours.
At least because it was not good, but I could ever
respond to this. I agree with the one point. I disagree.
I agree with him that IT is not some kind of magic. It's got to be done right for it to work. And we've heard from some places doing it right, and boy, it does work. And that's why this education issue is also a huge piece of this. Because if you just try to do it, I'm not sure, in fact, you'll ever see it. It will work right. On the other hand, if you do it right, I think we now do have a body of evidence to be able to speak to safety, efficiency, cost effectiveness, patient soundness, timeliness. Okay. And actually, as prices do drop, you do start improving equity as well. And that's the first part.
Probably help us to know some defenders in this case.
So I'm not going to use an IBM. The comment that I'd make is we have to keep in mind that the bulk of the healthcare dollar really goes to chronic disease. And there's not a lot of it, okay? And interesting, you know, there's various data out there to support this, but the average patient, you know, we get that national data on a 5,000 basis, you have on average between 5 and 10 physicians if you have a chronic disease. Those doctors don't talk to you. It's real obvious that, you know, the only way that we're going to actually make that work and reduce the redundancy and improve the quality of medical care and all that is if we get smart people information so we can make smart decisions. But all those smart people and physicians, I think it's what Dr. Burgess mentioned earlier, it's got to be in a way so it's not that the physicians don't penalize in the process. We've got 60% of those based on product. Right now, going to healthcare, which is far over in the country, and in the world, and in our outcomes, or not even in the type care right now. I think it's a shift in. But the dollar that we're talking about, Medicare, employers, and payers, are the ones that have been the biggest beneficiaries of these systems. We can shift the dollars, you know, to some extent from there to a primary care physician, which are the guys who really have to be able to control the healthcare system today.
Well, thank you. And once again, can I ask a short quick question? We haven't been able to do this for us, really, this is something I thought to be about this. And if the building on water that I just stick to our respondents to give us their impressions about what they like, what they dislike about the building. So, but again, this is important that we get it right because this could be the benefit for the next 2 or 3 generations of physicians or the benefit for the next 2 or 3 generations of physicians.
Certainly that would be appropriate. And there may be other questions from other members of our committee that we're not here. That may be submitted to you, right? And we would appreciate your response on that. I commend all of you somewhat different points of view on some issues, but generally I think there's a consensus that this is an area that is worth our exploring, it's worth us trying to move forward on the issue. And we appreciate your various points of view. And as Dr. Burgess indicated, if we can move a legislative agenda, we would appreciate your further comments with regard to that as well.
take profile notes. We do appreciate your time and thank you for your attention and your being with us on this occasion. I'm not going to join the hearing because we expect to have in the next few weeks a follow-up panel that will be from a federal point of view. And so therefore, in light of the fact that federal panel on the labor and the site generation, we will certainly just suspend this session of the hearing on the panel.